know about you, but I'm comfortable with death. Somebody else's. Right? Right. Yeah. I want to start off with a quote by Raphael Kushner in his book, Setting Your Heart on Fire. He said, embracing your mortality makes every moment extraordinary. Embracing your mortality makes every moment extraordinary. And he goes on to say, it opens you more than almost anything else can. The more you bow to death, it turns out, the more you come to life. The more I bow to death, the more I come to life. You know, I'm doing this series on Robert Brummett's book, Living Originally. And while I was early on, I think it was, I'm not sure what weekend it was, but I asked Reverend Kathleen if she would do the message because I was going to be out of town on one of the topics. And the topic was forgiveness. You know, we call it the F word, forgiveness, okay? And so I understand her, when I listened to Kathleen's message, she said, boy, what a, how convenient for Gwendolyn to be out of town, you know, when the topic is forgiveness. So a couple of days ago, I sent her a text, and I said, by the way, I don't think you had the toughest message in the series. I'm speaking about death next Sunday. And she texted back, and I believe her words were, it's my life. Death is my life. And so I asked her if she would just share with us a few minutes about what she meant by that and her comfort, her wonderful comfort with death. Because if you don't know, Kathleen is a chaplain, not a prayer chaplain, but a chaplain at Christus St. Vincent, and has so much experience in both chaplaincy and hospice that I thought it would be wonderful to hear from her. I actually wanted to have her do the whole message, but I
can't. Well, we were both working on a prayer chaplain retreat, and I really wish I had extended that to you, considering that you are in a place in your life where you're feeling the sting of grief. So we'll say a few things, and maybe you can come back and give us your powerful message. So thank you. I was looking around, I saw my head swiveling. I was looking around to see if Jillian Corcoran was here. I don't see her. I do see Deb Caswell. Is Deb, where are you? I thought I was like, yeah. Deb works at Christus St. Vincent, too. And chaplains aren't the only ones that deal with death. As a chaplain, our physicians, our nurses, and they are people that we, as chaplains, tend to keep an eagle eye on, because they also are confronted with these times that are so rich but still sometimes very intense. One of the things I noticed about our hospital is that there is compassion and love in delivery of all services at all levels. And I feel so honored to be invited to work there, to be a chaplain. So here's my short job description. And it fits with principle number 5 from Unity, walking your talk. You know, we do all 4 and then it ends up, let's apply it. Every day I walk in the hospital, no matter what entrance, I say thank you so much that I get to show up and express love here. That's the shortest job description, I think, in the world, being able to express love. And that applies to any job description, but in this case, particularly. So what happens with chaplaincy and with my familiar working with death? It actually all began with hospice. And hospice taught me how to be with others. When that probably is one of the worst days or most challenging days of their life. And so that carried over to the hospital. Now, creating safety when people are in fear, creating calmness and safety, showing up, creating a boundary of safety for a family that's waiting to see what's going to be the outcome here in the ED, what is going to be the outcome in the ICU, critical care unit. And so I'm grateful for that teaching. And I ask myself, have I gotten hardened to this? And I have not. Just last week, I had a situation where it was so close to home that I carried it all weekend. And when I showed up Monday, I said to another chaplain, I've got to process this death. And we did that. And then I went home for the rest of the day, just to rest and do what I needed to do. What that particular day taught me was I had some unfinished business, and I've been putting it off and putting it off. My children are and have been my life. I love them so much, and I have always wanted to write a love letter to them and leave it with my papers. Day I went home and I did it, and I cried and cried, and it was such a refreshing cry. It was such a renewing time, and it's done, and I'm feeling more prepared. So to conclude what I want to say, a couple of things. Number one, safety. Now today I was feeling very safe in my car in the thunder and lightning. I'm from Alaska, and we don't get this very often. And I ask myself when I hear it, I sure hope I know what I'm supposed to know about this. But I think if I'm in my car and there are rubber tires under me, I'm pretty safe, right? So that's where the rubber hits the road today. Right? Safety. Connect that. So there are ways to overcome when we know that we have fears around death. And that's by facing it in our own life, by taking steps to do what you really wanted to do. And if you got to the place where you were too ill to do it, then you'll have regret. So figure out what those regrets might be and address them now while you can. And, by the way, we have something coming up on June 27th, so Wednesday, where Jillian Corcoran is going to come and present information on advance directives. So I invite you to put that date down. Be brave, be strong, say, I'm going to face this full on, and come and hear what she has to say. I won't ask for a show of hands, because an advance directive is usually something we go, oh, I am going to do that someday, right? The titters tell me that's true. So let's address it on the 27th. And so I just want to end this, these comments with my best teaching book about death. It's a children's book called Lifetimes, the beautiful way to explain death to children. All children. And so I'm going to just read you the last page, because of course the name of the book is Lifetimes. So no matter how long they are or how short, lifetimes are really all the same. They have beginnings and endings, and there's a lot of living in between.
During this past week, as I've sat with this question of death and really reading Robert Berman's book, which is really a great chapter on death, to feeling excited about sharing this topic with you today. So that surprised me. That wasn't planned. You know, there's three human conditions surrounding death that I think are that come up that maybe all of us have in common. One of them is a fear of death. The second one is spiritually bypassing the topic of death, our own especially. And the third one is discomfort with the topic of death. So I don't think I'm alone in identifying those three things. And so when I think about the fear of death, I remember shortly before I became a minister, I was married at the time, and my husband was a very confident person in everything he did, much more confident of himself than I was of him when it came to sailing. And so we had a Catalina 25 and a dock or whatever at Heron Lake, and we would go up there on the weekends. And I really felt, you know, I was a licensed UD teacher, I understood these principles, and I pretty much would tell anybody that I'm not afraid of death, you know, that I've lived a good life, and, you know, if I die tomorrow, I would have lived a good life all as well. So we go out this particular day on this, you know, perfectly smooth lake, and we're just having a good time. There's a gentle breeze or whatever, and we're sailing, and it's wonderful. And as can happen for any of those who sail, no, out of the blue, out of nowhere, a squall came up. And I mean, we were rocketing and we were rolling. And I said, drop the sails. And he said, oh no, what we have to do is go sail into the wind. And I said, drop these blankety blank sails or I will never step foot on this boat ever again. And he did. And I mean, I was on the floor clutching my dog, Corey, at the head of the time of Dalmatian. And I was terrified. And I got it. I don't have a clue. I thought I wasn't afraid of death. But suddenly, when it seemed imminent to me, I got truthful with myself. And I realized that I had not quite overcome my fear of death. I sort of like to what Woody Allen said. How many know what Woody Allen said about death? You know? He said, yeah, I'm not afraid of death. I just don't want to be there when it happens. So that was sort of how I was feeling that day. And I think it's very important that we all give ourselves a break, because a fear of death like that is just normal, because our primal instinct is what? Survival. So of course, when our life is threatened in some way, we would be probably pretty abnormal, or really a good Zen monk or whatever, to not be afraid for our physical survival. And you know, I think that underlying, you know, they say that, what is it, snakes and public speaking are people's greatest fear. Well, guess what's underlying that fear? Death. You know? Wanda and I took my two adopted pooches outside my office the other day to see if they needed a relief break. And so we took them out there, and they're little. You know, they're about 20 pounds each. So we take them out there. We both walk up the steps by my back office. We go through the gate. We take them out there. I walk back down the steps with one of the dogs. And then Wanda starts to walk down the other one. She goes, yikes! There was a rattlesnake. Oh. Really big. And I go, give me the dog! Give me the dog! Later I said, I'm sorry, Wanda, but I figured you were big enough. Take care of yourself. So I was really worried about the dog, you know. So I want you to know this morning, I park out by my back office to make sure we have one extra space in the front. So I said, okay, I'm going to walk down those steps. And so I got out of my car and I said, here I come! Don't want to shake you up, don't want to upset you or shock you or surprise you. Here I come. And I walked by and I was fine. But then I realized I left something in the car. So I had to go back out, come back in. And I think a third time, I was getting ready to go out again because I left something at home. And I finally decided I could just stay at home. You know, it wasn't even my glasses, it was something else I forgot. But anyway, so, you know, there's that fear. And underlying that fear of snakes is what?
Yeah.
We're going to get bit and we're going to die. Okay? I have some more confidence around that. I don't know if you know, but a number of years ago, one of our youth, Shirley Shute's granddaughter, was bitten by a rattlesnake during our Easter egg hunt. And she thrived through it. You know, she was in the hospital 4 days, had 2 double doses of anti-venom, and I said, well, should we just not have Easter egg hunts anymore? And she said, no, we just have to be careful. You know? And so she, you know, I just was so impressed that she went through surviving a rattlesnake bite with such grace and no fluster. So, and I have to tell you what she said. I said to her, did it hurt, you know, because that's part of me. I don't like pain either. You know, it's right up there with death. And I said, did it hurt? And she said, well, it wasn't the bite. It was the venom that hurt. Pretty profound, huh? Mm. Think of that. It's not our bite. It's our venom. Mm. So anyway, so the fear of the snakes, underlying that fear is a fear of death. And what about public speaking? What's the fear?
The death of rejection.
Death of the ego. Somehow I'm going to be criticized, I'm going to mess up, I'm going to make a fool of myself, whatever it might be. But it's a fear of death that underlies that as well as being bitten by a snake. So the spiritual, you know, I like to have a, okay, so that's the fear. I think the spiritual solution to that particular human condition is assurance. Somehow, you know, what's that old song, Blessed Assurance, you know? We've got to have some kind of assurance that death maybe isn't as bad as we think it is. And I think what Reverend Kathleen said is true, that we've got to face it. And so that'll be in the how to. Okay. The human condition of spiritual bypassing. How many of you have heard the term spiritual bypassing? Not a whole lot of you, okay? Well, a spiritual bypass is when we go straight to an affirmation of truth or la-la land instead of really feeling our feelings, okay? So whenever the topic of my death comes up, I just go into, I am an eternal being, I am spirit, I am spirit, I am that part of me that was before the body and will be after the body. And I can say all these wonderful truths that really are assuring to me on some level. And I'm not saying don't use those. But don't use them until you've dealt with it. Okay? And that's what this preparation for this message did for me this week. Is that I realized, you know, I just don't deal with that topic. It's not something I want to deal with. And this whole chapter in this book, chapter 10, is about dealing with it. I mean, Robert Brummett, my spiritual director and the author of this book, was in a one-year group of about 30 people. And they all set a date for their death, not an imaginary date for their death, 1 year in the future. And then they got together once a month. And they talked about different questions that they addressed, you know, such as, why am I afraid of dying? You know, when I did that this week, I couldn't think of any reason other than maybe the not knowing when or how or if I was going to suffer or, you know, maybe, but I really couldn't think of any reason I should fear death. And anyway, there's a whole list of questions in the book that they would discuss every month. And apparently it was transformative for all of them, you know, to go through that experience. And so the next month they come and they had 11 months left, you know, and then 10, and 9, and 8. And I thought that was really would be a challenging group, but if anybody wants to do it, we'll do it, okay? Just fill out those slips. I don't see anybody reaching for one today. So I think that so we don't want to bypass, use spiritual principle as a way of bypassing our thoughts and our feelings. The spiritual solution to this is mindfulness. And that's what we've been studying in this book and in the messages on Sunday, the Sunday sunset. So to be mindful is to be aware of what are our thoughts about death. What are my feelings about death? And can I accept those thoughts and those feelings? Can I forgive myself if I have fear or concern or whatever? And can I be benevolent? Can I practice loving kindness with myself for this, and can I compassionately speak about it to myself? You know, because I think we're all pretty good about being comfortable, you know, with expressing condolences when, you know, you've lost someone. You know, I can be there for you. I can feel really comfortable, but this chapter really made me realize I just don't deal with my own death. You know, it's like, you know, I'll think about it tomorrow, right? It's like not something right there on my list. So that's a spiritual solution to spiritual bypassing, is to be mindful. And then the third one is discomfort around talking about the D word, right? Death. I realized when my beloved Snickers died, I said, he took on his angel's wings. And other people said, oh, we crossed the rainbow bridge. We say, they passed. Or we say, they transitioned. That's a good one in Unity. Unity people use that a lot. He made his transition. You know? And there's, you know, there's nothing wrong with it. You know, sometimes that's a gentle way, especially when you're talking to someone who's very much affected by the grief. But the point of it is, Snickers died, you know? And it reminded me, when I thought of this I had some of you may remember Veronique Marcel, who was a wonderful soloist violinist with the Paris Opera. And she brought some other violin students to Santa Fe several years in a row. And the first year, I invited one of these students to live with me for a while. Janet eventually rescued her, and she lived with Janet. Her name was Lar. And I had a picture of my dog, Corey, who I had recently put down, okay? And she asked where he was, and she didn't speak English, and I didn't speak French, and I had my little book, and she had her little book. And so I told her that I had to put him down. And she got this look of absolute horror in her eyes, and I thought, oh my God, what did I say? Well, it turned out I told her I had murdered my dog. So I don't think we have to be that direct, you know? We don't have to be that direct. But we do, we have this discomfort with the topic of death. You know, I always told him to lock the door so none of you could run out when you realize what I was going to be talking about. The way that I think we spiritually overcome that discomfort is to do it, to be willing to use the D word, to be willing to say someone died, you know, instead of sugarcoating it, and that we can do that compassionately and lovingly. But to not be so afraid of saying that word. I read a book once. It was a book from someone in the Mormon church. And it was the birth, death, the birth we call death. The birth we call death. And so I think that when we have, when I know the truth of my eternality, that I really do believe I live on beyond this body. I haven't got a clue how. I've got all kinds of ideas about it. I'm always a little suspect of somebody who says they know, you know. But to just be willing to embrace the fact that we are all going to die. You know, it's inevitable. Part of living is dying. I remember Larry Dossey once said, Dr. Larry Dossey, he's a well-known medical doctor and author here in Santa Fe, and he said, life is a terminal disease, or a terminal condition. Life is a terminal condition. And so I invite us to be comfortable and feel at ease. That's what my heart's desire is for all of us, that we can face our fear of death, that we can avoid taking a spiritual bypass by going straight to affirmations of truth before feeling and being in touch with how we feel about it, and that we will take comfort and have some kind of peace in talking about death. So, of course, how do we do that? What's the first how-to every week here at Unity Santa Fe?
Prayer and meditation.
And Robert says in his book, he gives a number of questions to contemplate. And what I love about it is he doesn't say that we have to think about and answer these questions, but he suggests that we just sit in the question. Or he says you can journal about it, two chairs, death is in one chair and I'm in the other, switch places, have a dialogue. But here are some of the questions. What do I fear most about dying? And I tell you, I don't have clarity. Why am I afraid of dying if I believe this truth? Pardon?
Oftentimes patients tell me it's pain, but they're
afraid. Oh, they're afraid of the pain, that they might be in pain before they die. That would make sense to me, because I don't do pain. I don't do windows, and I don't do pain. Who and what will I miss the most when I die? And I have to tell you, it's you. You know, this Unity Santa Fe family is what changes. What is important for me to finish before I die? The only thing I can come up with is get rid of the clutter so that all of people left behind don't have to use it for clutter. What legacy do I want to leave to humanity when I die? Well, I do have a will and I have a trust so that I have looked at, and I loved it. I had a brand new a financial advisor a number of years ago. And she did this, she was a Unity person in Kentucky. And they're still my financial advisors. And the first question she asked me was, what do you want to leave as a legacy? That was her first question. Not do you want stocks, bonds, or whatever, but what do you want to leave and who do you want to leave? It was just amazing. I had never considered that before. So I've done that part. But there's also that legacy of what difference do I want? What do I want people to remember about me? What difference do I want to have made in people's lives? And I think I could have some more clarity on that and live in such a way that that they'll remember that. And then what do I want shared in my obituary, eulogy, or epitaph? You know, how many of us have done our loved ones a favor and actually written our obituary? You know, of course, Kathleen. James says he has. I wrote one years ago that was very generic. I did not say what date I was dying or how I was going to die, okay? I was real clear about that. But I remember saying that in addition to having done a wonderful job as a spiritual leader of Unity Santa Fe, I became a leader in the Unity movement. And I have. You know, I read that way long time ago. And now, you know, like next week at convention, I'm leading a workshop for the whole Unity movement. And I've also served in many other capacities as a leader in this movement. So, and I'm going to, I'd love to do a workshop on this. One of my colleagues, I did not know him, but somebody posted his obituary on Facebook, and he wrote it himself, and he wrote it in first person. I was born, I did this. It was so cool. I thought, I want to do that. Of course, it's tomorrow. It's on my to-do list, but I haven't gotten around to it. So there's some real tangible things that we can do in addition to going into prayer and meditation and asking those questions of our heart, of our divine nature. And Robert says, if you're ever in trouble or whatever, imagine death on your left hand, to your left side, about a foot away or whatever he says, and turn and ask it. And so I thought, that's interesting. So I'm still playing with that one. To when I'm upset, when things are going, to ask death how to, you know, what's important here, or whatever. And to come up with a symbol. And my symbol, if you see the Unity wings up there, the very light right below there, that's the winged globe, and it symbolizes the soul taking flight above the earth. And so that was the symbol that came to me. But they were little fairy wings. So anyway, so there's all these things we can do to face our fear. Because you know, when I face something, it takes all the power away from it. It's like when I had a fear of giving this message, but when I just did it, when I faced it, I now feel very comfortable. And I hope it has blessed you all. And then remembering, yes, to remember my affirmations of truth, to give me assurance, but to not go to those before I really allow myself to feel my feelings and to have the thoughts I have about it. And then to just be mindful that, yes, maybe it's appropriate to, you know, I often say to people, I celebrate the person's life and that they've gone on to the next experience in living. And I think that's a beautiful thing to say to someone who has lost a loved one. But also to not be afraid of using the word death and dying and died. So let's just, I know that to the extent that we really do these things, that it will make a difference in terms of us feeling assured, in terms of us feeling ease, and that we will be doing a huge part to live our life more fully as we are willing to face our own death. And that when we do this, we will be stepping into that quote that I want to begin share with you from Raphael Kushner, that when we embrace our mortality, it makes every moment more exciting. It opens us more than almost anything else can. The more we bow to death, it turns out, the more we come to life. And so let's begin coming to life right now in the sacred time of shared prayer. So I invite us to just take a moment and breathe if you stop breathing, or if you're breathing a shallow or fast. Just allow it, just by focusing on it. It will bring itself into its own rhythm and pace. And I invite us to become aware of whatever may be going on in our thoughts or in our feeling nature about this topic of death, about what it would be like to have death be our advisor, our companion. And just welcome whatever feelings, whatever thoughts come up. Just embrace them. Maybe even silently ask forgiveness of yourself for avoiding the topic in the past, for any fear that you may have had, for taking a spiritual bypass. And to practice loving kindness to yourself. May I be happy. May I be free from fear. May I be assured of life everlasting. May I be comfortable in the face of death, my own as well as others. May I speak compassionately on the topic of death. And I invite us to just be with these ideas, with this inevitable reality. And as we gently bring our attention back to this time and place, silently say, or just feel gratitude as your divine self, as the eternal being, the eternal spirit that you are. Say, thank you. Thank you, thank you for the courage, for the wisdom, to fully embrace death as a part of life, and to deny it power over us. Thank you, thank you, thank you, that it is so and so is.